take a different approach, because obviously coming from consulting and just the gang and, you know, kind of just being open source and going after open source information, I was really helpful with everybody. But then when farmers became a thing, it almost seemed like conflict of interest for me to keep being so nice when I was just, you know, a lot of times training my competitors.
You could do so much, right?
Yeah.
So like,
so I kind of closed off from that.
For your homies?
Yeah.
Like I always look out for my homies, right?
Yeah.
And I can like show them where their water is, you know, and generally, you know, give them an idea of how to do that. But you can't hold your competitor's hand all the way.
No.
And I've done the same thing.
A couple people bit me in the ass. A couple people acted weird, you know?
Snakes in the grass everywhere.
Yeah.
You know, I opened up third-party engineering besides PSI. And when I did that, other companies followed the 3P certs and, you know, whatever, but it lowered the barrier of entry for machines.
Yeah.
And
well, PSI is fucking expensive for those that don't know, you know?
Yeah, yeah, 100%. They're great. They're great guys. They want to keep everyone safe, and that's the end goal, right? But, you know, I tend to open the market up like you do to even my competitors. And like you said, I like helping my friends. And yeah, realistically, a lot of my competitors are my homies.
Yeah.
Right. And, you know, even Kyle and Calvin and some of the guys that were at this, you know, party this weekend were direct competitors. But we love hanging out and smoking. You know, this table to that table, I like looking across and seeing who's there. You know,
well, and same with me. Same with me. There was multiple, you know, not a lot, but there was a handful of manufacturers that showed up and showed face. And it's cool, man. It's cool. Like, at the end of the day, there's abundance.
Sometimes, I say this all the time, man. You know, if I'm confident in what I'm doing and I open the door for five or six more fishes in the sea, it's okay, man. I know I'm going to eat, you know what I mean? So, you know, sometimes the pool's big enough for everybody.
Shout out to these guys, Headspace mini hash holes. They came by last night and hooked everybody up, and they're pretty good. They're out of Las Cruces.
Yeah. I went back to the hotel, and it's interesting. You go to one industry network, and everyone's smoking hash holes and the finest fresh press and, you know, some of the best cured rosin. And, you know, we go to the hotel, and most of the Canacon guys are there, and everyone's looking at my hash hole like, holy moly, like, what is this?
Like, you had a fucking lightsaber.
Yeah, you know, everyone, like, all, like, the auxiliary companies that are selling, like, tax services, that are smoking mids. It's like, you know, well, welcome to the real side of the industry. Here you go.
We'll see them there in fucking few years. Well, fuck yeah.
Canacon was interesting, man.
Yeah, what'd you think about that?
Small.
Yeah.
You know, and just, like, the community is small. You know, it's interesting seeing the Good Life gang being the center of attention. It's awesome. Shout out the Good Life gang booth. You know, that was awesome to see. Yeah. You know, Lex from the Good, from Solvent Direct, shout out. His presence was well known. You know, the balloon was half the show.
Yeah, Lex is cool.
Right there in front. And the party, you know, that was the buzz of the conference. And that's the first time I think that like a Good Life gang party was like where everyone in the conference wanted to go. That wasn't just
a I felt really bad. I looked at my phone after the party because we just were setting up shit and the rain and the wind. And I looked at my phone and I had like a lot of missed calls and a lot of missed text messages of people that were trying to get the address because they didn't realize it was a private party that they needed to do Eventbrite, even though I was putting fucking links in the whole nine. They didn't realize it was a private party that they needed to get tickets for, and they just wanted the address to show up because everybody at CounterCon was like, hey, go to this.
You did something right.
Yeah. So no, it was cool. I feel a little bad for my friends like you that came through, you know, for business. Obviously, at the end of the day, like, you want to make money, you want to get a lot of sales. And I think you're right. New Mexico is a very small market. I think people misjudge the amount of money we got coming in To the size of the market, to the actual market.
Oh, that is literally every cannabis company.
Yeah.
I own a facility in Maine. It's the same way. It's a small market. It means small customer base. It means not as much products moving off the shelf.
Yeah.
And those customers have to stay loyal, and you
got to. Oh, Maine's probably got even a smaller market than we do here.
Yeah. And I'm in a medical spot, you know what I mean? Which adult use is now a thing in Maine. So I'm trying to, you know, make our money. Yeah. You know,
that's Bridget.
Shout out Bridget Labs. Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Uh-huh.
Hell yeah. No, New Mexico's unique. This state has a lot of passion. They love their cannabis. They want a massive industry, but it is. It's very small. It's very niche. You have a lot of established companies already. And there's only so much money to make.
Everyone wants to vertically integrate themselves. No one wants to work with other people.
Correct. And that's where, you know, at the end of the day, it's hard. It's hard to create a good clientele base because we're not vertically integrated.
No,
we're manufacturers.
I assume it's the same people that you've known for many, many
years. Many years. Yeah. We came into the industry when it was medical still, and then it went rec last April. So we're still a baby rec market. And these first numbers that I think everybody's looked at for New Mexico are like strictly Texas-based. I mean, not strictly, but I would say fucking 60% Texas-based. And I don't think people really realize that the reason New Mexico's market is so great is just because of Texas prohibition law. And, you know, me and Dustin were talking about, you know, when that's gonna stop and, you know, where they're, if, you know, they changed medical. So that's really big. Have you heard about that?
Yeah, and that market's going to blow up quick. I imagine just as much as Texas does anything.
Well, Texas is going to be the biggest. And in my opinion,
you know what I mean?
My opinion, the best. As far as money-wise and lucrative.
I haven't looked at how they set the licensing up. And to be fair, that as they go from medical to adult use, that's what's going to determine.
As far as lucrative cannabis business, I think that Texas has such a massive population. There's so much money there. They are not a poor state whatsoever. I think that...
And you're referencing that because New Mexico is the poorest state technically in the country, right?
One of poorest, lowest education. I mean, we've got worse crime. Like, we've got horrible stats.
There's crime everywhere.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah, I don't know. And I feel bad because all the homies came to town and I probably should have really seen where they got Airbnbs.
So I went to McDonald's. And the person from McDonald's was telling me that someone got shot. And then I went to the pet store and the pet person who was checking me out told me that they got shot in the parking lot.
We have a lot of gun violence. Yeah. There's a lot of drug violence, you know, meth, fentanyl.
But that's like any city now.
It is. It is. It seems like the most populated place in each state has the same bullshit going on.
Well, this is where we find all of our laboratories.
Yeah.
Exactly. I go state to state to state to state. And every time I go into a laboratory, I'm driving like a regular car. I'm not wearing anything flashy. I'm like trying to keep my head down. And that's unfortunate, but you know, that's realistically where the zoning for the cities wants you to go, or light industrial places where all the sketchy shit happens.
We've got a joke that whenever like an out-of-towner asks us like, oh, how's the crime in Albuquerque? Like we heard like they steal, the car theft is really high. We'll tell them, oh, you're good as long as you don't park your car outside. That's the joke. And they'll be like, wait a minute.
I will say the majority of people here are really nice.
No, we have there's a cool culture here. There's a lot of good things here. And I think that the weather's cool.
The culture is cool, man. So like you're connected to the MMA fights and a bunch of other things. You know,
it's a fight town.
You don't see many cities where like the cannabis companies are actually involved with local events that aren't pop-up tent related.
Yeah, no, we do concerts. Last year we helped bring Ice Cube and a whole bunch of fucking Paul Wall, Too Short, Baby Bash, a whole bunch of big artists out here. Then we threw some concerts of our own. We're super lucky to be able to be that entangled into just New Mexico culture, New Mexico nightlife. They're pretty welcoming of cannabis companies. I know Jackson Wink MMA Academy, they were completely cool with having all cannabis sponsors. So
That's what's up.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, a lot of sports aren't super for it. And, you know, we're seeing now, like, was the NBA just allowed? Was the NFL started allowing?
The NBA has always been cool on cannabis. They don't test. They've never been a large testing organization where they, like, give their guys pot drug tests. So that's always been a unique thing about the NBA that's not, like, talked about as much. Whereas the NFL, they, like, specifically test for cannabis.
That's messed up.
Yeah. Well, and that's how we've seen so many good...
It's an enhancement drug.
Yeah. I mean...
Because shout out cannabis, it enhances
I guess
your flow state of mind. I assume.
You know, I had somebody argue it before. And I mean, I guess there's points where it could be. I guess I use it to enhance my fucking day, so... But is it steroids? No.
No.
So, if that's what we're after... Why are we testing for fucking pot?
Now they're taking away a bunch of people's awards for it too.
Oh, you gotta love that.
Yeah.
Didn't they take away the Black Girls Award, the award, the runner?
Yeah.
The Olympian?
Yeah.
That's bullshit.
Yeah.
So I guess we should play.
It's another way for another. I mean, for a pothead, like, their entire life, people have been striking us down for smoking weed. To, like, win a Olympic award or, like, a big award like that and then be struck down after doing something great, man, that's terrible.
Yeah, I guess we'll probably get started. Welcome to the Pharm Table. Why don't you introduce yourself?
What's up? I'm Alex Barsky. I'm Alex Barsky. I'm the owner of C1D1 Labs, founder, sole founder. I design and fabricate extraction manufacturing equipment.
Nice.
Butane, ethanol, in addition to Class 1 Division 1, Class 1 Division 2 extraction rooms. And auxiliary equipment like chillers, heaters, and so forth and so on. We work with companies all across the nation, like yourself, farmers, and companies, you know, all across the East Coast, up and down California. We started in California with a bunch of local companies by lowering the barrier of entry into, you know, really extraction by educating municipalities, fire marshals, building departments, fire departments, and getting, you know, the price of extraction rooms lower and, you know, creating a competitive market with the manufacturing equipment. We created an opportunity for a lot of our friends to afford to get to market and not blow themselves up in their garage. And that's really how we got started. And since then, we've been able to provide these services for companies all across the country. We're working in South Dakota and almost in Hawaii. And it's a blessing to be now taking what we did in a closet, you know what I mean? Very unsafely. And now do it safely across the country in the most vast places. And, you know, we've built over 200 labs and no one's gotten hurt in one of our rooms.
Nice.
Which is dope.
A lot of our
friends are buying our, you know, $40,000 room, which is a low price entry booth. And that wouldn't have been possible when, you know, companies like FlexMod that are out of business was in the industry and you were paying $200,000. Like, so it's very dope to see our friends succeed, you know, people like you, in addition that we hooked you up with affordable room to create.
Yeah, no, you guys made it. We were actually, fun story. We were actually New Mexico. We were actually blasting outside. We were running a closed loop outside in a caged off area. And because of a certain somebody in New Mexico, they would actually prefer you to do it outside. From an operating standpoint, it's great and all, but it's not ideal. You know, it's obviously not where you want to.
Not so clean. From
a cleanliness point, especially exactly. Not with a fucking dust devil coming through.
If you're trying to create food grade product, that's difficult.
Yeah. So, anyways, but that's how we started because we just didn't. I didn't have investors. I didn't have anybody to fucking buy a booth for me. So you know, I did what we had to do.
Dilution is a solution.
When we did decide we were going to move and the landlord actually didn't want us doing anything outside. And he didn't even want a booth outside. Cause at first I had pitched to him, well, hey, for space, let me put the booth outside. He didn't even want a booth outside. So that's when you guys came along and said, hey, you know, we can make this more affordable for you. And we got the components and we did it ourselves. We got our own engineer, but you were there the whole step of the way. helping us, helping with the state regulators. And yeah, it's passed and does well.
Yeah, helping with the regulators and getting people passed is really, really our specialty. You know, a lot of companies that were doing what we were doing before we did what we did were really using the lack of knowledge on the consumer side, which is a business owner, to profit. And by doing...
Yeah, it's predatory.
Yeah,
sure.
they would make it extremely difficult for you. Unnecessarily difficult. And the reason why it was unnecessarily difficult is because they had no applicable experience. They were just like making stuff up based upon other industries that had nothing to do with what we were doing. so like one of the things is like, for example, PSI would make you roll out your tank in Denver. So like that was how like the industry started. And like, I thought that was ridiculous. I thought that like rolling a carbon steel tank outside and filling it back up was kind of silly. So like having the ability to change a fire protection report that was a hazard analysis report that we, you know, really designed as far as creating, you know, a floor plan and having equipment certifications and NFPA 1 compliance and then SDS sheets and creating this, you know, hazard analysis specifically for this industry, specific for these set of codes. And when we went across the country, you know, teaching these set of codes, it was actually in a form of shifting liability from the fire department onto our engineer, right? And that included a new SOP for transfilling, right? Which we could then use indoor transfilling is the word we use.
Yeah.
And that allowed us to jacket our tanks and use, you know, nicer tanks here in California. A lot of people were struggling with that and it was annoying.
Yeah, our regulator didn't give a shit. He's like, yeah, you guys can fill them in the booth. You're good. And so we were like, cool.
Yeah, you guys are crushing it. You know, I think that you guys have a beautiful stance in the industry. You know, I travel the country, right? And I see a lot of labs, and the only labs that I see that are set up with like water hash, butane, and ethanol, A to Z, are multi-state operators. So it's wonderful seeing a grassroots homie like yourself.
It's taken a lot. It's been a fun ride. But yeah, I'm really proud of what we got going on here. Really proud of my crew. We've put together an amazing crew that just, they crush it. Not only that, they're just
Cody's amazing.
You got good-hearted guys.
Yeah, you know, you got smart technicians, and your lab's clean.
Thank you.
Super season. Thank you. I'm proud of that.
No, because I mean, my car's not, and my life's not, but the lab is, and yeah, it takes a lot. Anybody that's had a facility of any size, you know what I mean? Even a small facility, it takes a lot to just keep up, not only on the management of production and like pushing out a product and
equipment,
but you know, actually having a clean facility, getting your crew to respect it, getting your crew to constantly hold that standard. It's a lot. And you know,
it takes a boss.
These guys do great, so I can't take the credit for it at all.
So one of the things I want to talk about is, I guess, your diamonds. You guys are growing some fat diamonds, and we got you a diamond mining pot going. And
we love it. So the new technology on that is pretty smart.
So the idea is we're using two check valves, and it's going to be a patent-pending idea that we created. And we actually created it in a diamond mining class. You know, shout out to...
Well, you've been going to all the classes lately.
Yeah. So shout out to Diamond Alchemy. Shout out to Dread Pirate. Shout out to Make BHO Great Again. They were doing this diamond mining class, and everyone was talking about how they were breaking up their pucks. One person was banging on the wall. One person was banging on the shoe. The other person was banging on the table. And these three options were by far the top options of what's happening. Yeah. And you know, I asked people, like, how often does it break? And they all shrugged. They go, only like 1 in 100.
Yeah.
But like, I counted the room. I was like, well, there's 50 people, you know, 50 people here. That's 50 jars. You know what I mean? Like, that's a lot of butane. That's a lot of, you know, pentane. That's a lot of opportunity to fuck up. Yeah. And it's also product.
So I felt really bad. I got to cut you off. I felt really bad. So I showed Cody that tech because I would bang it on the table. You know, get to the corner of the stainless steel table and then just give it a couple of controlled smacks.
So this was like controlled.
And one day Cody comes in and he's just pissed. His face is red. He's got like shards of glass on his fucking chin. You know what I mean?
No.
And not like in his body, but he's got dabs all over his chin, all over his shirt.
Shout out Cody. He always wears his safety glasses.
And he wasn't. he wasn't physically hurt, but he was fucking pissed. And he was like giving me that look like, why'd you fucking show me how to do that? Dude.
I've been doing that for years.
It was a horrible idea to show me how to do it like that. And I felt bad because I was like, fuck, I shouldn't have done it.
So he's shooting nitrogen underneath.
Yeah.
Right? And from what we've seen, about 50 PSI, it'll break a puck. And we've got, you know, Dabitarian has one, and Mike Gnarly has one. And we're hoping to see them, you know, hopefully using that the new top secret class. Out in Oakland.
What I thought was cool about it is, so we got it. You know, Cody and the techs filled it up, and we let it sit, whatever. I don't know, 3-4 days until we, you know, could visibly see there was a puck, and we hit it with nitrogen, and it broke, and it created this, like, you know, there was some large chunks that were like sticking out of the terp layer. And then we went back the next day and it was another puck, but the like shards were still, chunks were still sticking up. So we broke that again. And so by the end of it, so we ended up breaking it like with the nitrogen like 4 or 5 times. So we had this like ice plate. Like, have you ever seen when the boats like go and they build up all the
ice sheets?
So that's what the diamonds look like, because it was one puck. It was like 4 pucks.
They were stacking on top of each other.
Yep. And it was just, you know, assorting themselves all fucked off, you know, however they landed. So
you have different people doing SOPs differently. So, to be fair, we're in the beta test and everyone's doing everything a little bit differently. And I'm kind of sorting people to do so. One person waited until it was completely done to push it.
And we did it. Like I said, a few days. It was R&D. We had never fucking broke pucks like that. You know what I mean? So we just wanted to see what it would do.
But it's new technology. And you know, when we finalize, you know, how this is done, we're super stoked about everyone using it. We have jacketed bottoms that are 6-inch, 8-inch, and 10-inch that are just bottom tri-clamps, but they have heat on them.
Yeah.
Which is great for reflux on any of these units, because you have a heated bottom and it can cool the top. But we have full sight glasses with 4 sight glasses on ASC each side that are rated to 350 PSI. And then a normal lid. So you can have pretty much any 6-inch sight glass you have laying around. You can put this puck pusher heated bottom on it and make it into a diamond miner. And if you want to be a badass, you could do an 8-inch or a 10-inch one and do, you know, a 20-pound run into one unit.
I'm interested in the rack you were telling me about. So that sounds pretty cool, because obviously once you get big enough, especially if this motherfucker's full of fluid in the bottom, it's too fucking big to try to tip. I mean, maybe I could do it. Maybe a good-sized guy could do it. But just your average tech, it's a liability to have them tipping
1,000%
over this fucking 50-pound fucking tank, you know?
So Dabitarian already ordered one, so he's gonna have one. It's a rack like 4, so he ordered 4. We can obviously do whatever. But he's going to run hot fluids through one and cold fluids through one, another, so he could quick crash in one and then, you know, slowly grow in another. And he's got what we call tilt mechanisms on each one of these diamond miners that allows you to pour off the diamonds.
Nice.
You know? And that should save, you know, obviously a lot of stress on people picking up these diamond miners. And to be fair, you know, this is product.
Right? Well, Cody brought up a good point with the rack and some casters.
Oh, shout out Quick Connects too.
Yeah.
Because that makes everything awesome.
Well, so with the rack and some casters, we could roll it into the booth, fill it right directly from the machine, and then roll it out of the booth. And easy as fucking
shit. With AI around the corner, we'll have robots doing this.
Yeah. Oh God. Don't tell fucking Luna the invented fucking the AI fucking butane machine. I heard their operators fucking set it and go home. I was like, man, that's gonna.
Dude, so our company peer reviewed that model.
It's gonna go down someday.
Our company peer reviewed that system to market.
Yeah.
So up until that point, there was no Chinese chillers that were really accepted.
Yeah.
But they found a really good manufacturer, and they used, you know, the correct certified parts in the machine to do what they had to do, and. They crush it, yeah. So shout out, you know, Lunatech and their team and everything they do. You know what I mean? I'm super proud of working with them and you know, yeah.
What's the next step? What's the next step for C1D1 Labs?
C1D1 Labs, you know, we're kind of doing it all right now. And stepping back and really making sure that what we're doing is 1000%, you know, the client's expectations is really where we're at. And, you know, maybe automating a machine in the future and coming out with new technology. We have a few things cooking, that should change the game. You know, I can't speak too much of it because I don't want to drop some,
yeah, of course, of course,
whatever, but, you know, they absolutely, you know, we got some really smart people behind the teams, and we're working with, you know, a lot of guys like, you know, Chaz at Friendly Farms, and, you know, a lot of local guys have been making wax for 10 plus years like yourself that have some ideas that they want to finally get out to market. And I think you're working with these guys and working with, you know, people like, you know, Dread Pirate and yourself and experts, you know, like that's where we're at as well, is helping these people get their ideas.
It's cool to see companies actually finally listening to cannabis guys, to actual guys that are experienced in the industry, experienced in culture, and then building equipment based off, you know, practical shit, stuff that's actually going to work in the lab, that's actually going to give you the result you need.
Yeah, so at one point, everyone was getting funding, and the funding was overcapitalized, and it led to manufacturers selling and buying, you know, a lot of expensive shit that really people didn't need. And, you know, for a lot of big, big, big companies, you can see this in, okay,
we saw it in Hempocalypse.
I took $4 million, now I need 10, now I need 15, now I'm, you know, screwed. Yeah. But, you know, for smaller companies, that just means I'm out of business 6 months later,
yeah,
right? And if prices go down in addition to all that, you know, that makes things worse. So,
oh yeah, I'm constantly seeing hemp equipment that, you know, didn't have many miles on it at all getting kind of recycled back into the industry for pennies on the dollar.
They all got picked up.
Yeah.
Well, prices of distillate went up in Cali, and all that equipment got picked up pretty quick, it seems.
So right. we'll see how long that lasts. Where's it at now? Like
so
2K?
Everyone's got a different opinion
on
how and why prices in cannabis go up and down. You know, I think in my opinion, it's got a lot to do with, you know, where my neighbors are setting the price and my mentality on how I'm approaching the market, right? Are they begging for my product? Do they need my product, et cetera? There is an underlying tone to most industries and where it's going. The internet does a lot for the cannabis industry, and I think that the influence of what some of these market shareholders, in addition to just, you know, people on the internet that have a lot of followings, how they approach their marketing is directly influencing our market in different directions. And I think that, you know, as little as it has to do with actual biomass and ins and outs, it affects how you and I create our prices and look at the neighbors and think about how we're competitively going about it. I think that, like, when things are going really good, I'm going to look at your price 22 and go, ha, I'm doing 23.
Yeah.
You know, my shit's better than yours. I'm going to be charged better. So when, you know, it's going bad, I can manufacture more than you. So I'm going to go less.
Well, and it bottomed out. I mean, the distillate price in Cali had bottomed out bad to where a lot of people lost it unless they didn't have a massive operation going. So to see it go back up, I don't know. I'd like to think that they just said, okay, fuck, we're gonna stop fucking all of, you know, ourselves.
Let me reference this. When in the traditional market, shit would go dry.
Yeah.
And for some people, you know, that had weight, you know, there is opportunity to charge more for your bud, right?
Yeah.
And then when shit went back again, you know, sometimes prices would get really far down. And, you know, there'd be, you know, an alignment in the traditional market, which is not really allowed in the real markets anymore, of, hey, this is what we should charge for our product. You know what I mean? And I think now the understanding of people who are new to the cannabis industry are kind of getting that influencer type thing. And like people are learning how to set their prices based upon their quality of product and what it is. And I think that hopefully could help stabilize the market, in my opinion. But yes, I think the input of biomass is difficult right now. Finding biomass is difficult for a lot of people. those vertical companies are charging more.
Yeah,
for sure.
Well, and I mean, as they license more companies and as more people come online in every state, I think you're going to see, you know, there's trends in different products, and who knows, you know, the trend might be higher on distillate right now and they're eating just that much more.
Oklahoma's crushing the distillate right now.
It's popular in New Mexico too.
Yeah.
I think
Michigan has good distillate prices right now too.
I think it's highly underrated as far as a business decision. Because there's a whole
vitamin E thing took a big hit on the distillate market.
It did, but I think it's rebounded. I think it's rebounded, and I think that your average cannabinoid,
the human consumer market has been through so much worse than the vape apocalypse.
Exactly.
And a little bit of branding will fix that, in my opinion. I totally agree with that.
Well, and people just realize that it wasn't distillate's fault. Yeah. It was, you know, something else. And I think if you look at
how many edibles are being produced now, you know, and consumed by market, you know, one of the biggest growth target audiences is like the elderly.
Yeah.
Right. People who are like from generations where it's just not like as socially accepted, and they always normally go, you know, try to edibles first, right?
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people who don't smoke, and
I think that's a bad idea. I don't think new cannabis users should try edibles first. I think it's a different feeling.
I like to smoke with a grandma.
I think the best way to try cannabis is just smoke flower first, and then as that doesn't do the trick, try other things. But
It is nice that it's dosed and regulated.
Yeah, I guess.
I mean, so back in the day, you take an edible, you have no idea how much. it is converted in your organs, and it does make a stronger effect.
Yeah, I started eating that Rice Krispie treat. I have no fucking clue. Somebody made it and gave it.
That looks delicious. Apparently, there's only 100 milligrams in the whole thing.
It's massive, so I'm thinking that's wrong.
Do you mind if I try a little bit?
No, you can definitely try some.
Yes. And there's only THC in it?
I mean, it feels like it. My body feels like it's only THC.
I'm going to eat the part with all the sugar.
Yeah, it's really... So what it is good tasting. It's very buttery.
So even there's like, you know, lines in the chocolate that dose you. If it's good, you don't see the lines. You just taste it.
No, it's really good. So shout out to...
I taste it.
I do. That's what I said. It's cannabis butter. But, I mean, that's good.
I miss making cannabis butter, bro. I used to make so much of that stuff.
It's nostalgic. But it's super buttery, and it's not doesn't sound like taste like it's...
So there's still markets selling like home goods like this.
Yeah.
In like vacuum seal bags over the counter. With jars that you can dig your hand into and pick out and put into a bag. You know what I mean?
That's crazy.
A bartender uses like a fancy prong, but.
A fancy prong?
Like fancy chopsticks to pick out your buds.
So do you eat more green and red chili since you've been down here?
Green chili only.
Green chili only? No more red?
No, I mean.
RIP your sweater?
RIP. No, I got it out.
You got it out?
I got it out. That was a Bridget Lab sweater.
Oh, man. I was telling Dustin how the waitress was roasting you.
Now fucking I'm a professional. Savage. Now I'm a professional chili eater, bro.
Fucking tourist.
Come on. I guess Dustin knew. Dustin green chili.
Green chili. Green and red chili this morning.
It was the first thing I asked. I landed and I texted you. I was like, where are they? So it was ironic. I guess it was, you know, probably 10 minutes after I landed, I went to the rental car place and the lady was like, yeah, I go to Frontier or whatever. It's right by the airport and they have great green chili.
Yeah, they're good.
So within 30 minutes of being in New Mexico, I was told to go eat green chili.
Yeah, that's the college spot. That's like the 24/7 go to the after the club spot. They're always open.
Not like tired off an airport.
Yeah, you know. Well, cool. Where can people find you if they want to follow you, if they want to get some equipment, they want to talk to you about a C1D1 booth?
C1D1labs.org is my website. C1D1labs is my Instagram account. There are a few of our Instagram accounts. C1D1labs is our main Instagram account.
Yeah, you got a fucking bunch.
Yeah.
Are you expecting them all to get taken down or what?
Honestly, the idea is it very much like domain space.
Yeah.
You know, And that's where I come from, is from tech and selling weed and trying to create, you know, a non-9-to-5 life. But those are my website. That's my Instagram. You can call me direct, 510-410-1083. I'll pick up the phone.
Damn, Mike Jones just gave out his number on air.
Mike Jones.
All right, man. Thank you for coming down. It's been a pleasure. We hope to have you back to New Mexico soon.
I'll for sure be back, Donnie. Thank you for having me.
Oh, yeah. Welcome to the Pharm Table.